Hello, hello, welcome to my channel. I'm Molly, and today I am drawing bees. Yes, bees. I'll be explaining my process in depth of creating a balanced composition with this piece specifically. If you're not really into art or you're not really interested in what I'm doing, then this will probably be a very boring video for you. You may be more interested in the speed paint, which you can find right here. Before I get into the technical aspect, I want to talk briefly about what inspires me to draw bees. I'm not an expert on the environment, but I do care deeply about the well-being of our planet. In 2016, the bee population declined by 44%, according to the Bee Informed Partnership. You could say that this piece raises awareness, but a lot of it I did for myself and my own peace of mind because it is something that I care about. With that out of the way, let's get into the sketch. Right now I'm blocking out the structure of my piece. I want to do an abstraction, which is when your subject is referenced to something in real life, but kind of broken down in some way. In this case, I'm going for a very blocky, kind of cubic shape, and I'll be deconstructing their visual appearance so they'll look a little deformed. To create a sense of depth, I'll be using scale and overlapping the subjects. Objects further away will appear smaller, while objects closer to the viewer will appear larger and they'll be overlapped on top. Because I'm still sketching and the page looks really messy, I'm shading the objects that are further in the back. This won't appear in the final piece, but it does help me to identify what's what, so the whole thing just doesn't look like a big clump of lines. You may notice that I have one long, swirly line going around my subject. This represents the honey, because the rest of my composition is cubes comprised of mostly vertical and horizontal lines, it will feel extremely stagnant and boring. I'm using the swirly honey to create more variety in the piece and add that movement that it so desperately needs. Because it's the only thing in the entire piece that has curves, your eye will automatically be drawn to it more because of its contrast against the cubes. I'm going to be using this to my advantage. The swirled line also acts as a guiding line, which is a crucial element in a composition. It will guide the viewer's eye all the way from the bottom cube to the top, or vice versa, so that the eye moves around the whole piece. Now I'm outlining the basic shape of the bees. I want them to be all positioned at the same angle, so I'll be creating the same cube over and over again. It's basically just copying and pasting. This is called repetition, and artists often use this element to create unity and harmony. It's more effective than if all the bees were different shapes and facing different angles. This would just create chaos, or a more technical term would be discord, because the elements just aren't working together. My idea is that there will be baby bees, or larvae, at the bottom, and as you get to the top, the bees will get older and older. To complement this idea, I'm making the bees at the bottom smaller, as they would naturally be. And they would get bigger as they get to the top. This is called gradation, which is an element of unity. It's kind of like when you use a color gradient in Photoshop, so the colors gradually change from one to the other, but instead I'm applying it to size. I'm just going to go through and add their little faces and details. I plan to use a lot of flat colors, so there won't be much texture or shading in the actual coloring process. To make up for that, I'm using my own spin on hatching in the line art. Now I'm just going to go through and finish lining the piece with a basic round brush in Photoshop. I have a lone honeypot at the bottom of my piece. It's very isolated. Your eyes are drawn more to areas with more visual weight, and isolated shapes carry more visual weight than shapes that are closer together. Because I have a massive bees at the top, I am hoping that isolating the honeypot will balance it out, but the bees may still be too overwhelming, just because as a whole they're so much bigger in size. Hopefully I can fix that in the coloring process. I decided to go with a split complementary color scheme. It may sound complicated, but really it's just one color plus two more colors that are directly next to both sides of its complement. I'm going with orange, a bluish purple, and almost an aqua. I'm mostly going to be working with orange and the kind of aqua, and I'm saving the purple for accents. I don't have to stick with these colors in their exact state. I'm going to be changing their saturation, value, and even their hue for a more visually interesting composition. I thought about using the bright orange for the top bee and the honeypot, but again, since all the bees are just so much larger, giving them a highly saturated color would just put all of the focus at the top. Ideally, I want my composition to be balanced all around, but if anything, I want it to be bottom heavy. This replicates what we see naturally, like dark colored grass against a light airy sky. Going back to what I said earlier about the honey being the guiding line, I'm emphasizing that idea by coloring it a bright, highly saturated orange. Colors with more saturation and darker values carry more visual weight than desaturated colors. That's why I'm also desaturating the orange and changing it to more of a muddy brown, while leaving the pot the same bright orange. You may notice that the main line of honey is very defragmented, but a more proper term would be detached. Detachment creates more variety in a composition. But since I still want it to be one cohesive line of honey, I'm using continuation, which is why all the separate drops and lines make up one big, long line. Your eye will naturally collect the dots. I'm definitely a lot happier with the piece after making those adjustments to the bees at the top, but it still feels top-heavy to me. Luckily, text also carries a lot of weight, and it just so happens that I was planning to add text to the pot anyways. I'm adding the phrase, save the bees. To complement the grid-like structure, I want text that can easily form the shape of a box when you put them together. The one I'm using is a sans serif font called Carbon, made by Raymond Larrabee? Either way, sans serif just means that the characters don't have the little projections that you see on fonts like Cambria and Times New Roman. To me, it just looks a lot cleaner. I'm using all caps because that way all the characters begin and end at the same height. For example, in a lowercase h you have that little curvy part that looks like a lowercase n that is only as high as the middle of the character, while the ascender or the tall part extends all the way to the top, whereas in an uppercase h you have both towers on the sides that start and end at the same height. So I'm hoping that when I string all the uppercase letters together, it'll be easier to read, because again, you'll have that continuation of the tops, bottoms, and sides of the letters to form a box. I know that sounded extremely confusing for such a small detail. I tried to explain it in the best way I could, but hopefully you'll get it when you see it. My composition still feels top-heavy, so I desaturate the top bees even more. Now I'm pretty satisfied with it, but I forgot one thing. In the sketch I had drawn out larvae scattered around the honeypot. I accidentally left that out when I was doing the line art, but thankfully I remembered it at the end. Adding these small details definitely gives me what I was trying to accomplish during the whole process, which is more weight and emphasis on the honeypot. With the isolation, saturation, contrast, and text, I feel that the honeypot finally has enough visual weight, enough to make it the focal point of the piece. Finally, I go over it with a paper texture set on soft light that I found on Creative Commons, which is a site that compiles free-to-use content. I hope you enjoyed my video. Thanks for sticking all the way through it if you did. I know it was long, but I hope you learned a thing or two. If you did like it and you found it beneficial, then I highly recommend that you subscribe for similar content. Thanks, bye-bye.